Hello students, today we will discuss refraction through spherical surfaces. So we can start with the spherical surfaces first. What are spherical refracting surfaces? A spherical refracting surface is a part of the sphere of refracting material. So if you see, the interface which is separating two media is having spherical shape. A refracting surface which is convex towards the rarer medium is called convex refracting surface, and the if a refracting surface which is concave towards the rarer medium is called concave refracting surface. So you can see both of the surfaces here. You can see this surface is convex towards the rarer, from this side, from rarer side you have to see the surface, and from here, from the rarer side, you will see the surface, it is concave. So media, they have been shown here. Radius of curvature is shown. Now this line APCB, this is the principal axis. C is the center of curvature. Center of curvature means one. What? When you will complete this curvature, you will get a circle or a sphere, and you see the center of that sphere is called the center of curvature. This is the pole, this is a point on the spherical surface, and the radius of curvature is P. Pole you will join with the center of curvature, that is the radius of curvature. You can join any point on this surface, spherical surface, with the center, that would be the radius or of curvature. As we know that in case of a circle or sphere, radius is not one. Any point on the surface of the sphere or the circle can be joined with the center, and that would be the radius of curvature. Similarly, here you can see all these things. This is the principal axis, this is the pole, this is center of curvature. You see, you will complete the sphere in this direction. So in this way, the sphere would be completed. So center of curvature is lying here. R is the radius of curvature. Now, for you see, when we have to see the refraction through the spherical surfaces, we have to assume some points which are important. Some approximation we will use here. So what are the assumptions, what we are going to assume for these, for derivations and for deriving the formula between the different physical quantities for the spherical surfaces? So let us see what are the assumptions. First thing is, object is the point object lying on the principal axis. So we'll do the calculations and the derivations for the point objects. Actual objects we will not consider. The incident and refracted rays make small angles with the principal axis. Third is the aperture, that is the diameter of the curved surface is small. And sign conventions, let us discuss. The incident ray is taken from left to right. For our this lecture, we are taking incident rays coming from left to right. All the distances are measured from the pole of the refracting surfaces. The distances measured along the direction of the incident ray are taken positive, and against the incident ray they would be taken as negative. So this third point is very, very important. If any distance, you have to start measuring the distance from the pole, and if you are measuring the distance in the direction of the incident ray, that distance would be taken as positive. And if you are measuring the distance against the incident ray, that distance would be taken as negative. Vertical distances measured from the principal axis in the upward direction are taken positive, and all the downward direction distances are negative. Refraction at convex surface from rarer medium to denser medium, that is a real image we will get. So we will consider the refraction at convex surface first. This is the convex surface which is separating one denser and rarer medium. Mu1 and mu2 are the refractive indices of the two media here. C is the center of curvature, P is the pole, and this is the principal axis. and we'll consider one point object O is lying in the rarer medium. You can see the refraction, how the refraction is taking place. You see, this is the ray, incident ray, which is incident on this surface, and this will, you see how we can draw the normal here. If you want to draw the normal, you will join this point with the center of curvature. So that would be the radius of curvature also. And you see, radius is always perpendicular to the tangent drawn on the spherical surface. So this is the way how the refraction is taking place. Two incident rays we have drawn here. One is this blue line and one is this orange line. So blue line is, you can see here how the refraction is taking place, and this orange line is going to incident here at point P, pole. And you see, this is making an angle 0 degree, and angle of refraction is also 0 degree, so it is going without any deviation. So you see, this normal is drawn here by joining this point with the center of curvature. So when the ray of light is going in the denser medium, it is not going straight forward in this direction, it is going to bend towards the normal. So it is going towards the normal. This is the angle of incidence. So what angle of incidence is? Angle between the incident ray and normal is the angle of incidence. And we have drawn one perpendicular from point A where the refraction has taken place. Angle of refraction we have drawn here. Angle of refraction is what? This is the angle between refracted ray and normal. Now, for our convenience, we are going to consider some other angles. You see, whenever we need to apply the Snell's law, we must have this angle of incidence and angle of refraction. But you see, in these derivations, in this chapter, we would be interested in perpendiculars and bases. And for this, you see, this is not here, you are not able to get any perpendicular or base for this angle also. So that is why we are going to take some angle, we are going to consider some angles on the principal axis. So first angle is alpha at the point object O. Second is beta, where image is formed. And third is gamma, where center of curvature is there. So three angles you have to consider. Alpha, beta and gamma. Alpha is the angle at point object O, beta is the angle at image, and gamma is the angle at the center of curvature. Now this is the radius of curvature, this is u, distance of object from the pole, u, and v is distance of image from the pole. Now from here, you see, we know that exterior angle of a triangle is always equal to the sum of two opposite interior angles. So you can see from here, angle I is the exterior angle of which triangle? You need to see the lines, sides. One line is this, you will extend it in the backward direction. One line is this, you will extend it in the backward direction. From these two lines, you can find out which triangle, for which triangle this angle is the exterior angle. So triangle is which? You can write a triangle is AOC. So for the triangle AOC, I is the exterior angle and it is equal to alpha plus gamma. So alpha and gamma are the two interior angle of the triangle. So we can write I as alpha plus gamma. Now similarly, you can write R also. R is not the exterior angle, it is the interior angle, but gamma is the exterior angle. So gamma can be written as R plus beta. So R can be written as gamma minus beta. So we have written I and R in terms of the angles alpha, beta and gamma. Now tangent alpha, from the triangle you can write tangent alpha is what? AM perpendicular over base, AM over OM. Or alpha is equal to MA over MO, which approximation we are using here? So one assumption we have already considered, that these angles, these incident rays, refracted rays are making very small angles with the principal axis. So when the angle is very small, when theta is very small, tangent theta can be written as theta. So tangent alpha is written as alpha here. Tangent beta is written as MA over tangent beta. So in this triangle, right angle triangle, you see MA is the perpendicular for all the three triangles. So tangent beta is MA over MI, or simply beta is equal to MA over MI. Similarly, tangent gamma is what? Tangent gamma is MA over MC, or gamma is equal to MA over MC. Now, what we have to do? Snell's law will apply. Snell's law says that sin I, mu 1 sin I is equal to mu 2 sin R, or sin I over sin R is equal to mu 2 over mu 1, or as angles are very small, angle of incidence I and angle of refraction R are also very small, so sin I can be written as I, R, sin R can be written as R. R multiplying, cross multiplying, what you will get? Mu 1 I is equal to mu 2 R. Now you see, I is what? I is alpha plus gamma, R is gamma minus beta. So let us substitute the values. I as alpha plus gamma, R as gamma minus beta. But you see, alpha, beta, gammas, they have these values. So you will substitute these values and you will multiply and rearranging the things. What you're going to get here? Mu 1 over PO plus mu 2 over PI. And one more approximation we have used here. This point M is lying very close to point P. So M would be replaced with P. So wherever you have got MO, MI, MC, you will get PO, PC. Because you see, we need to measure all the distances from the pole. That is why this point M is lying, because aperture is also very small, so this M would be very much close to point P. So again, one more approximation we are going to adopt here, that M is lying closer to P, so M would be replaced with P. So this is again for our own convenience, because it would be convenient for us to measure all the distances from the pole. So PO, PI and PC you are getting here. Now using the sign conventions, you see, what is PO? PO, you have to start from point P. You are going towards O. You see, you are going against the incident ray. So U would be taken as negative. For measuring PI, you will start from point P and you are going in towards I. And you are going in the direction of incident ray. So PI is positive V. And if you are measuring this R here, you will start from point P, pole, and you will go towards C, and again you see you are going in the direction of the incident ray. So again R would be positive. So using these sign conventions, when you will substitute the values, you will get one relation. Mu 1 over minus U plus mu 2 over V is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 over R. So this is a relation between U, V, R and refractive indices of the two media for the refraction at convex surface when the object is lying in the rarer medium. So what we have done here, you need to keep in your mind first step. This is step number one. So basically this derivation is done in three steps. First step is you need to write, this is the first step, you need to write I and R in terms of alpha, beta, gamma. And second step is you will find out tangent alpha, beta, gamma. And third step is you will apply the Snell's law. And again you will substitute I and R in terms of alpha, beta, gamma, alpha, beta, gamma in terms of the bases and perpendiculars. And then a little bit simplification will give you the result. So you need to keep this derivation in your mind with these three steps. Refraction at convex surface from rarer medium to denser medium. Let us consider this is the convex surface, but here you see object is lying closer to pole and the image which is being formed here, that is a virtual image. You see here object O is lying here, and you see when this is going towards the normal, but it is very much closer to the point P, as if it is moving towards the normal, but it is not able to touch the principal axis. If it would actually touch the principal axis, only then you would have got the real image. But you see, this is not going to touch. So your principal axis and this refracted ray, they are the diverging rays. They will never meet. So when they will never meet, we generally extend the rays in the backward direction to find out an imaginary point where they would appear to meet. So here both of the rays appear to meet at this point I in the rarer medium itself. So when rays are not actually meeting but they appear to meet, we get the virtual image. So again, using the same steps, I and R, you will write in terms of alpha, beta, gamma. What would be I? I would be alpha plus gamma. And what would be R? R would be, R is the angle between this ray and this ray. So R would be beta plus gamma. So using the same three steps, you would get this relation. Refraction at concave surface. Concave surface, you can see here, object is lying here, and you see when it is going in the denser medium, normal is here. Now you see center of curvature is lying towards the center of this surface. It is lying outside in the rarer medium. So here you see this is the normal drawn in this way. So ray would be bending towards normal. It is going away from the principal axis, so it will again never meet the principal axis, and again we will get the virtual image. And when you will extend it in the backward direction, you will get the image here. So again we are taking the same angles alpha, beta, gamma, and again writing, again using the three steps, you will get the relation between the three physical quantities U, V and R with the help of mu1 and mu2, that is this thing, mu1 over minus U plus mu2 over V is equal to mu2 minus mu1 over R. Convex surface, and when you are getting real image, so here object is lying in the denser medium. And again you can see the ray would bend away from the normal, because it is going away from the normal, so it is going to meet the principal axis actually and will give you the real image. Again you will use the same relations, same three steps, and you will get the relation mu2 over minus u plus mu1 over v is equal to mu1 minus mu2 over r. Refraction at convex surface, and here you will get virtual image. And so you can use any of the situation, you will solve with the help of the three steps, and you can get the relations. So again you can see relations are same when the object is lying in the denser medium, or if they are lying in the rarer medium, the relations you can derive with the help of the three steps. Some notes. Expression for object in rarer medium is same for whether it is real or virtual image or convex or concave surface. So we have seen the expressions when the object was in the rarer medium, all the expressions were same for all the cases. This was this mu1 over minus u plus mu2 over v is equal to mu2 minus mu1 over r. And expression for the object in denser medium is same for whether it is real or virtual or convex or concave surface. So it was mu2 over minus u plus mu1 over v is equal to mu1 minus mu2 over r. So what is the, you can see what, how we can learn this. Only mu1 and mu2 would be replaced when the object is lying and in the denser medium. However, the values of u, v, r, etc. must be taken with proper sign conventions while solving the numerical problems. So whenever you will solve you are given any numerical problem, you have to use the sign conventions again. The reflective indices mu1 and mu2 get interchanged in the expression that we have already discussed. When the object is in the rarer medium or when the object is in the denser medium, whatever be the situation, only mu1 and mu2 would get interchanged. Next is Lensmaker's formula. This is a simple lens. Mu1 is the refractive index of the rarer medium. Mu2 is the refractive index of the denser medium. This is the principal axis. Point P1, P2 are the poles for the two different surfaces. C1 is the center of curvature for this first surface. And for this surface, center of curvature is C2. Object O is lying here. Now you see here, when object O is lying here, the ray is incident from the object on the first surface and it is going here. You see here we have neglected the second surface and the ray is going straight forward and going to meet the principal axis at I1. So we have fully ignored the second surface. But second surface is there. So refraction will take place at the second surface also. And now you see I1 is the angle of incidence for the normal N1. For refraction at LP1, N. So this surface LP1, N. For this refraction, you can write the relation that we have already solved, as the image is formed in the denser medium. So you see, if this second surface is not there, if we are neglecting the second surface, then we will consider that whole of this medium is the denser medium till I1. So I1 is in the denser medium, object is in the rarer medium. So this expression we have already derived for this type of situation. Now you see, if now you see second surface is there, here refraction is taking place. So actual image is formed at point I. For refraction at this point L, P2, N. Now you see at this surface which ray is going to incident. This ray is going to incident. But this ray, from where this ray is coming? So this ray appear to come from I1. So I1 is a virtual object for the second surface. And I is the final image for the second surface. And C2 is the center of curvature for the second surface. So here, using the second surface, which relation you will get? Mu2 over minus CI1 plus mu1 over CI is equal to minus mu1 minus mu2 over CC2. As the object is in the denser medium and the image is formed in the rarer medium. So this ray is actually coming from the denser medium. So this is a virtual object basically. Combining the refractions at both of the surfaces. So you will add both of these equations and you will get this relation. Mu1 can be taken to other side. Now proper sign conventions we are going to use here. So you will get this relation. 1 over minus u plus 1 over v is equal to mu2 minus mu1 over mu1 times 1 over R1 minus 1 over R2. So this is very important relation and is called Lensmaker's formula. Mu2 over mu1 can be written as mu. So simplifying the same formula, we will get this relation. Or mu2 over mu1 can be written as mu of medium 2 with respect to 1, or simply mu. When the object is kept at infinity, image is formed at the principal focus, that we already know. So mu is, we are going to substitute infinity, and we are going to substitute as f. So you will get this relation. So this equation is called Lensmaker's formula, or simply Lensmaker's formula. We have simply replaced 1 over minus u plus 1 over v is equal to 1 over f. So the relation we have got is called lens maker's formula. And from above these two relations, we have got the lens equation. So this is the lens equation. 1 over minus u plus 1 over v is equal to 1 over f. Now let us check principal focus. First principal focus is the point on the principal axis of the lens at which, if the object is placed, image would be formed at infinity. So this we already know. So this is the principal focus and this is the first principal focus. Second principal focus is the point on the principal axis of the lens at which the image is formed when the object is kept at infinity. So image is formed at the principal focus F2. So in both of the diagrams you can see F2 is the second principal focus. Thin lens formula, Gaussian form of lens equation for convex lens. Principal axis, focus, first and second focus, 2F1, 2F2, they are the center of curvatures. So double the focal length. Let us consider any object is lying between focus F and 2F, and this object AB is lying here, and you see using the rules of refraction you will get the inverted real magnified image B dash A dash on the other side of the lens. This is u, distance of object, v distance of image, F is the distance of the focus, R is the radius of curvature. Now concentrate on these two triangles. These triangles are similar, so corresponding side ratios are same. A dash B dash over AB, this perpendicular over this perpendicular must be equal to the ratio of the bases. If we are taking this perpendicular, you will take the base of the same triangle, that is CB dash over CB. Now concentrate on these green triangles. These are also similar. So again we are using A dash B dash over MC is equal to, so both of the perpendicular ratios must be equal to base ratios, B2 F2 over CF2. Or, but MC is what? MC is equal to AB. So we have replaced MC with AB. Now you see for this triangle and this triangle, for this triangle this is number 1 and this is number 2. Left hand side of these two equations are same, so right hand sides must be same. CB dash over CB is equal to B dash F2 over CF2. Now little bit simplification, CB dash over CB, what is BF2? BF2 can be written as CB dash minus CF2. You see why we are replacing this? Because all the distances are to be measured from the optical center of the lens. So that is why we are converting the distances from point C. Now using Cartesian conventions, CB is what? CB is minus U. CB dash is V plus V. CF2 is plus F. So substituting the values, you will get, and little bit simplification, you will get the lens equation, that is 1 over V minus 1 over U is equal to 1 over F. Linear magnification is what? Linear magnification produced by a lens is defined as a ratio of the size of image to the size of object, I over O. So from the last triangles, A dash, B dash over AB, CB dash over CB, Cartesian conventions we can use, sign conventions, I over minus O, AB would be minus O. So sign conventions for lens, linear magnification for the lens is v over u. In terms of f and v, you can use the Lenz equation and you can replace the things. Different formula for the linear magnification you will get. Power of a lens is what? Reciprocal of the focal length. Power of a lens is the ability to bend the ray of light falling on it and is the reciprocal of the focal length. So when F is in meter, power is measured in diopters. Very important unit. Unit of power of lens is what? That is diopter. So that's all for today. Thank you.